And fell among thieves who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, "Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come back, I will repay you." So which of these three do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And he said, "He who showed mercy on him." Then Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this time and for every time, Lord, that we come before you and we come in your presence, O Jesus, and we pray for a word from you, a meal that will satisfy our souls and our spirits, and we pray for anointing, we pray for empowerment. We don't want to hear big words, we don't want to hear philosophy, we don't want to hear eloquence. We just want to hear you, O Holy Spirit, speaking to our hearts and ministering to us and just letting us what you want us to hear. We want to hear what you have to say, and we want to just react appropriately to your word and submit to your word and to grow in knowing Jesus more and to living a life that pleases you, O Jesus. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, this section, what's it famous for? It's talking about what? Good Samaritan. Very good. All right. How many people or groups of people are mentioned in the section of the Good Samaritan? 3. Any other ideas? 4. Any other ideas? 5. Any other ideas? Let's start naming them, and then let's see who's right. 6. Any other ideas? So come on, start naming. Well, no. Okay, now we're going to try to figure out which number was correct. So let's just name people. Priest. Levite. Samaritan. The injured one. Innkeeper. So yes, but that's kind of before, that's why I was trying to specify, but I didn't know if I was clear. So the actual, like when Jesus started talking about the Good Samaritan, so this is past now the conversation. But if we want to talk for the whole story, fine, we'll say the lawyer, okay? The thieves. 12. What do you mean? Oh, 12 number of people? Okay, so we got, we have 7, we have 5 more to go then. Help me out, who are the other 5? Or are we good? The donkey's a person, come on, that's mean. Plus, is it a donkey, by the way? NIV says donkey, huh? That's why I don't read the, no, I'm just kidding. any more? Well, if you include that, then you can include Jesus, right? If we're taking past That part. Okay. Huh? So they said the innkeeper. Okay. So it's on my heart. So we'll go through the kind of the section fairly quickly, but it's on my heart to focus on five people. And that's the thieves and the priest, the Levite, the Samaritan, and the injured one, the actual guy, the poor guy that's in the story. But what I want us to look at when we get to that section is to really focus on where do I find myself? Who do I identify with from these five groups of people? And just kind of focus on that. So let's go through the verses. Luke 10, verse 25. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him. So here the guy's occupation is what? Lawyer. You hear that, Andrew? He's a lawyer. So what's a lawyer? What's a lawyer's like expertise? Huh? Yeah, they're an expert in the law. So this guy's a lawyer. He's an expert in the law, right? That was not a trick question. That was supposed to be an easy one. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him. So he went to Jesus, and his purpose was, unfortunately, the motive behind what he was talking to Jesus about was not a good motive. It was to test Jesus. The question he asked is a really good question, and it's a deep question, and it's an important question. Behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" Question mark. And he thought he got Jesus. He thought, that's it. You know, I'm going to capture him by my question, and he is going to be, you know, he's going to fail. You know, everyone has been trying to capture Jesus, to corner Jesus, and no one has been successful, but I'm a lawyer, I'm an expert in the law. So I asked him the question, "Listen, I want to inherit eternal life, so what do I do to inherit it? What should I do, or what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" So Jesus answered him. Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law?" Now you notice here Jesus is very, obviously he's very good. He knows what he's doing. So he flipped it back on the guy with a question. But when he gave the guy the question, he gave him a question with something he's very comfortable with. Remember, what's the guy's occupation? Lawyer. So he asked him about what? The law. He said, "You're an expert in the law. Why don't I ask you, sir?" He said, "What is written in the law? Tell me, what is really written in the law? And then I want to know also, what is your reading of it? I want to understand your perspective as you read the Word of God, as you read the law. What is it that you get out of it? You help me answer your question." And so here, and this is actually a great method, by the way, when we talk to people, a lot of times we rush into like telling them what to do or how it happens or how to get to heaven. But a good way is to start out by asking them, what is their understanding? What is their perspective? What is it that they understand about eternal life? What is their, you know, you ask people, it's a question I like to ask people, it's like, what's your prescription to get to heaven? If you had to write me a prescription to get to heaven, what would you write on it? And then this way you understand what their understanding is, and then you build on it. And you go from there. You'll know some of it may be very truthful and some of it may be very false, and then you can build upon it. So that's exactly what Jesus did. He says, "What is written in the law? What is your reading of it?" And he went to him with his comfort zone, with his area of expertise. And so he answered, the guy, the lawyer, answered and said, "You shall love the Lord your God." And then he talked about four things here. And all of them is an all-inclusive, not like a little bit. "You shall love the Lord your God with," first is all your heart. So meaning, when it comes to sincerity, make sure it's full-on sincerity, all your heart. Second is with all your soul. When it comes to your emotions, make sure you love God with all your emotions. The third thing is with all your strength. When it comes to the level of love you have, make sure it's really strong. It's as strong as it can get, with all your strength and with all your mind. When it comes to intellect, make sure you intellectually love God completely, logically. You fully love him. And then he says, oh, and there's this other one too. And your neighbor as yourself. Okay, so that's his answer. He said to him, Jesus answered, and he said, "You have answered rightly." Good job. do this and you will live. Remember, what does the guy want from Jesus? What's his question to Jesus? How to get to heaven? How to get to eternal life? And how does he want to get to eternal life? What's the prescription that he wants Jesus to write him? It has to do with what? Huh? Doing, action, works, right? And so Jesus said, well, tell me what's in the law. And the guy said, the law says, my interpretation, really, if I want to get to heaven, it boils down to two things. And that's loving God with all of me. We talked about the heart, the strength, the mind, and your soul. Love him from all of those. So loving God and loving my neighbor, but not just loving my neighbor as myself. And Jesus said, you got it. You nailed it. If you really do that, and Jesus told him, he was being honest with him, you have answered rightly. If you want to approach God, if you want to get to heaven through works, you got it. That's how you do it. Do this and you will live, not might. Yes, you'll be saved if you do that. Now, I'd like you to raise your hand. If you love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind. Raise your hand, please. Good. Oh, good. I'm glad. Maybe you could teach us how to do that. Fine. Now let's try another one. Raise your hand. Not do I want to, but meaning. So if I really, let me explain that. If I really love the Lord from all my heart, that means I'm 100% sincere always in my love for God. If I love the Lord always from all my souls, that means my soul, my emotions are completely God's, and they love God completely. And if I truly love God from all my strength, that means you can't get me to stop talking about God. I talk about him when I wake up, till I go to bed, and all in between. That's all your strength, because my love for him is so strong, I can't talk about anyone else. And then if I love the Lord from all my mind, my intellectual mind, my thoughts are nothing under except under God and loving God. I fail in all four. But I'll get advice from. So now the other one is, raise your hand, not if you love your neighbor, but if you love your neighbor as yourself, as much as you love you. And those are two very hard things. And Jesus said, you guys remember the pastor in the morning, in the beginning of the message, he said, God gave people 4,000 years to try to live this, and not one was successful. And that's why Jesus was able to come, and he was able to fulfill both. And he fulfilled actually the whole law, and that's why he was able to pay the price and save us. So Jesus said, go ahead and do that. Now look at the crazy thing. In the next verse it says, but he, the lawyer, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Now, I don't know if you get a little baffled by this or not, but why does the guy need to justify himself? When do I justify myself? When I'm doing something wrong, when I'm in a rut, I'm trying to get out of it. So I'm like, well, no, see, really what I mean, really meant, and how it really went down, and all these things. Did anyone accuse, and usually I'm going to justify myself, when someone comes to accuse me, I may be correct in what I have done, but I need to justify myself. What? Someone is like pointing a finger at me. Did anyone point a finger at this guy? Did anyone tell him, oh, you got some explaining to do, young man? Did any of that happen? No. But what happened is when the law, he's a lawyer, he's an expert in the law, and then when Jesus brought the law to him, and he actually brought it through himself, the guy realized, man, I'm guilty. I don't love God. And I definitely don't love my neighbor. And then he's like, why do I have to put that last part as myself? I mean, if you love your neighbor, if you ask any of us, do you love your neighbor? All of us will raise our hand. I can guarantee you. But when you say love your neighbor as yourself, all our hands are withdrawn, because you know some of our neighbors is like, really? No. And so he started to feel guilty. Because he realized that to get to heaven by works is not going to happen. And so at this point, rather than justifying himself, he should have gone and he said, you know what, I failed. I can't do it by works. How do I get to heaven, Jesus? He should have done that. But he wanted to justify himself. And so his question was, who is my neighbor? Why did he ask that? Well, because he figured the God part, you know, it's he knows he falls short. But he's like, well, maybe if I could just figure out who's my neighbor, start there, you know, and then maybe I can get to loving God with all these four aspects completely, all with all of me. So he said, who is my neighbor? Why does he want to know this? Honestly, I think because if I can figure out who my neighbor is, and I mean, I hope Jesus is a little not too, like, inclusive, you know, I hope he can exclude a few people, because, I mean, he didn't say love your relative as yourself. I could do that one, you know, love your nuclear family as yourself. Love your kids as yourself. Love your spouse as yourself. Fine, those are easier. But your neighbor, I don't know my neighbor. I don't know half my neighbors. Love them as myself. And so he was hoping, like, what is the definition of neighbor so I can, like, know who it is that to try to love them as I love myself, and hopefully it's not too many people, and maybe this thing is doable. Then Jesus answered and said. So here comes what Jesus said. Now, just from a theological standpoint, this Jesus never mentioned this, that it's a parable. So is it a parable or not? People differ. But parables, there are clear parables where it says, and Jesus said this parable. This is not one of those where it says parable. Some people believe it's a parable. Some people believe, no, it's not a parable, because if this was a parable, this would be unwise of Jesus to call it a parable, to use Samaritan when he's talking to Jews to make a point. And where do I stand? It doesn't matter to me, but people like to fight about these things. So just so that you guys, if you see someone fighting about it, just, you know, this is one, it's not worth it. Just say, yes, I agree with you. Which one do you believe on? Which one do you believe? And whatever they tell you, say, you know, I was thinking that. Just make sure no one else is from the other side, or else you could be in trouble. Or try to be neutral, but how do you think? What do you think? That's interesting. I'm going to think about it. You know, anyways. So then Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. So I'm going to take the very fast, quick part of this. I'll take some symbolism into it, but that's not what I want to share with you guys. That's not what's on my heart. So this guy went down from where? From Jerusalem to Jericho. So Jerusalem is high on a mountain, Jericho's down, and he's going on his way up or down? Down. Going from Jerusalem to Jericho, because this is, I'm going to need to focus on that in a little bit. From Jerusalem to Jericho, and then what happened? As he's on his way there to Jericho, he fell among thieves, and they are robbers. And what did they do? They stripped him of his clothing. So they wanted to steal everything. So they took his clothes, they stole that. And then they wounded him, they hurt him. And then they departed, they left him. And what was his state when they left him? Leaving him half dead. I don't know, is he alive? Is he dead? He's just barely surviving, this guy. So these people met him and they did that to him. Now by chance, a certain priest came down the road. And so here, if we're talking symbolism, so we're talking about a sinner, a man, walking in the path of life. And as the sinner walks in the path of life, demonic powers come and they want to hurt the sinner. They want the sinner to end in hell. So they want to leave the sinner dead, or they want to kill the sinner as much as possible. Now in the path of life, now this guy is now half dead. Two people come and pass by him. And now by chance, a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by the other side. A priest is someone who teaches the law, someone who carries the law, someone who does sacrifices and things like that. Verse 32, likewise a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. So both of them ended up seeing the guy, and both of them ended up leaving the guy. What's a Levite? So there's how many tribes of Israel? 12. And which one of those tribes that the priest comes from? Levite. So here this guy is not a priest, but is a Levite. Is every priest a Levite? Yes. If you went like that, I know you meant this way. So every priest is a Levite. Now, is every Levite a priest? No. Very good. Now you're like, ooh, now I'm dizzy. Okay. So, so here, They're both from what, not just God's chosen people, but they're God's, like, very chosen people. They are God's people who carry the law, who serve the law. And so the rest of the Levites, the ones that are not priests, they serve the temple, they serve the tabernacle, they still do God's work. They're the ones in ministry. So here, both of them, what they ended up seeing the guy. They can't pretend they didn't see the guy. And both of them left. What is this talking symbolism? Meaning, the law cannot save. When the law came to try to help a sinner in the place where he is at, the law failed. The law left the guy still half dead in his place. And that's why it works. And Jesus is trying to answer the guy, law cannot save you. It is not works that saves you. You need the Good Samaritan. You need Jesus Christ to save you. But a certain Samaritan, who is a symbol of Jesus Christ, as he journeyed, came where he was, to that place, and when he saw him, he had compassion. And here talks about Jesus Christ. He comes, he came to our earth, and he saw our state, and he had compassion upon us. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds. First thing he did is he didn't say, oh, you sinner. But first thing is he took care of our need. We're half dead, you know, and the guy's wounded. So he took care of his wound. He bandaged his wounds. And then after that, he poured oil and wine on it. Both are symbols of the Holy Spirit. So here he says, oil, I give you anointing. I'm going to anoint you by the Holy Spirit. The only way for you to be saved is for you to be born from God. You need the Holy Spirit. That's the oil. But also wine is the joys of the Holy Spirit. When salvation happens, not only do you have the anointing and the filling of the Holy Spirit, but also you have the joy of the Holy Spirit. And then he set him on his own animal. Now here he put him on this animal, and the animal carried him. Who's the one that ended up carrying him to the inn? The animal, not Jesus, right? So he put him on the animal. Who is the one that leads us through our journey? The Holy Spirit. And so he took him on his animal, brought him to an inn. So took him to this place. It's called an inn. It's like a hotel. And took care of him. And where does Jesus, through our journey, as we live, as he leads us through, he fills us, he anoints us with the Holy Spirit. He gives us the joy of the Holy Spirit. He leads us through the Holy Spirit. Where does he lead us? He leads us to our local church, our place where we can go and grow together, and people to take care of us spiritually. So he took him to the inn and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And then he still took care of him for that night. On the next day, when he departed and Jesus left, he's not here right now. He's in heaven. But who did he entrust us with? The Holy Spirit and who? And the church to take care of us. Departed, he took out 2 denarii. So here, 1 denarii is worth how much? A day's worth of work. So he took out 2 days worth of work and he paid. Does he know this guy? He doesn't know this guy. Okay, let's say you make $10 an hour. All right, to make the math simple, $10 an hour. You work 8 hours a day. Let's assume, let's pretend, let's dream. No taxes, okay? No taxes. Uncle Sam doesn't take anything out. So how much money do you make in a day? Wow, you guys are really good when it comes to money, huh? So I'm just kidding. So now 2 days worth, how much is that? 160. Would you, okay, your 2 days work, you, let's pretend all of us make this much money. You make 160 every 2 days. And you go, you find some guy on the street, okay? You go bandage them up. I mean, already, I'm feeling good already, okay? I bandage the guy up. And then I'll take him in my car. The guy looks dirty, man. But I take him in my car, drive him to an inn, and I get out my last 2 days worth of work and go give it to the innkeeper for a guy I don't even know. And then I leave. But that's Jesus, okay? So Jesus did that, and he paid money, and he paid a lot of money, but then he didn't just pay the money and leave. He's leaving. Obviously, Jesus where is in heaven, but who did he entrust with us? He said, it is good for you that I leave, right? In the Gospel of John, he says, good for you that I leave because I'm going to give you a comforter. You need the Holy Spirit. That's better than me being here because you have him always. You have my presence with you always. But I also gave you believers. I gave you an inn and I gave you an innkeeper. People, spiritual people take care of you in a place, in a local home that I can take care of you. And so he did that, the innkeeper, and said to him, take care of him. Listen, innkeeper. Listen, believers. Take care of the little ones. That's the command from Jesus. Make sure you take care of the little ones. Take care of them. And whatever more you spend And when you take care of them, spend on them. Okay? Spend your time, spend your energy, spend your efforts on the little ones. But don't worry, it's not coming out of your pocket. Okay? And you know I'm good for it. When I come again, and Jesus is coming again, guys, I will repay you. He already paid two days worth of work, and he's going to pay however much it costs to take care of this guy he doesn't know. Pretty amazing story. Now Jesus asks the guy a question. Which of these three do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? That was Jesus' question. He said, the lawyer answered him, he who showed mercy on him. Which is which one? Which one? The Good Samaritan, right? And so what did Jesus say? Then Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. Okay, go ahead, be a Samaritan. Quick question. Did Jesus answer the guy's question? No. What was the guy's question? How to get to heaven? Yes. But then he told him, right? He answered that question. The guy answered his own question. And Jesus says, yep, you're right. And then the guy tried to justify himself. So then the guy asked another question. What was the other question? So the first question was answered. Does anyone disagree? If you want to get to heaven by works, what do the law completely? Can anyone do that? No. But that was answered. He said, who's my neighbor? Did Jesus answer him, who's my neighbor? No. Yes. So who's my neighbor? That's my neighbor. But do you see what happened? The guy said, the guy's question is this. I'm supposed to love my neighbor as myself. So who's my neighbor so I can love them as myself? But Jesus twisted it. He did a really cool twist on the whole story. He says, no, no, no. It's not who is your neighbor. It's who do you want to be a neighbor to? It's very different. It's not the same thing. It's not about, let me find the bare minimum that I can do. Who can I love so I can just find, I did this, all right, now here it is. Can I get to heaven? But it's more like, who can I be a neighbor to? Who can I love with the love of Christ? That's who you should be. Do you guys get it or am I confusing? Can we say it again? So here, let's go this way. Verse 29. But he, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? The guy never said, who am I a neighbor to? No, he says, I want to know, who is my neighbor? Jesus asks at the end, verse 36, so which of these three do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? I'm not asking you who's your neighbor. I want to know who you are a neighbor to. Now let's get back to the story. The first group of people I want to look at are the thieves. The thieves, what did they do when they met this man? They stripped him, verse 30, of his clothing, which you can look at it as they shamed him. They put him to shame. Wounded him, so they hurt him. And then they left. They left him half dead. And I wonder if any of us identify with the thieves. You know, I know if I ask, you know, who's a thief, who's a robber, no one is going to raise their hand. But I want to look at it in the words of what the actions of these thieves. They stripped him of his clothing. That is equivalent to shaming someone, meaning calling someone names, putting someone down, harming people verbally. I wonder if we are thieves tonight. The second thing that they did is they wounded him, they hurt him. And I wonder how many times we've deliberately hurt people. We did things to harm them, whether physically, whether emotionally, whether in whatever way, you're just like, you know, I'm out to get this person. I'm angry, so I'm going to be a thief. That's exactly what I'm doing. I'm going to be a robber. I'm going to be like these people. You know, in the Gospel of John chapter 10, and verse 10, it says, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. And that's Satan. He's talking about Satan here. That's his purpose, is he wants to steal. He wants to kill. He wants to destroy. He says, but I, Jesus, I have come for a whole different reason, that they may have life, but not just any life, and that they may have it more abundantly. I'm game to give abundant life. And I really wonder if any of us are thieves tonight. You know, as I was reading this, it was on my heart last night, and I kept thinking, and I woke up this morning, I was praying and thinking a little bit, I was like, man, how many times have I been a thief? Have I hurt people and done things to people? And, you know, I said, man, that's not that far. We think thieves are these bad people, but sometimes we are those bad people. And I really pray that if you or I are thieves today, if we search ourselves before God, we find ourselves hurting people, we find ourselves wounding people, we find ourselves, we just love to put people down, we love to call people names and do things like that, I really pray that we would understand that the thief came to do these things, that that's the work of Satan in our lives. What do you mean, I'm a believer? You know, Peter, who's the number one believer, the top believer, Jesus was talking about his cross, and this is exactly the same time, Jesus had said, you know, who do people say that I am? And they're like, you know, you're this, you're that, you're a prophet, you're... And then he says, well, who do you say that I am? And then Peter comes out and he says, you know what, you are the Son of God. And then Jesus tells him, you know, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, Peter, but it's my Father in heaven, and on this rock I will build my church. This rock doesn't mean Peter, because people got confused and turned into this weird thing because Peter means rock. So on Peter, the church will be built, and they built this whole fake thing that doesn't make any sense. But on this rock, I will build my church is talking about on the truth that Jesus is the Son of God, that he's the Savior. On this rock, I will build my church. And then afterward, Jesus talks, like the next paragraph, Jesus talks about, he says, you know what? The Son of Man is going to be handed over, and he's going to be crucified. And then Peter, who just got told that, man, this is something been revealed to you by God himself, he said, far be it from you, Lord. And you know what Jesus did? He turned to him and he says, get away from me, Satan. So we could be on the mountaintop spiritually, and in a second, we're under the influence of Satan. Not demon-possessed, but under the influence of Satan. A believer cannot be demon-possessed. But Satan can deceive us and can trick us. And that's the thing, you know, how many of us are under the influence of Satan. Are under the influence of Satan where he plays with our flesh. They hurt me. They've gone too far. And I'm fighting back now. I'm going to stick it to them. They call me names. I know how to call them even better names than what they call me. They fight and I'm going to fight back. It's going to be an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. I'm going to go and I'm going to hurt whoever gets in my way. I'm going to go and shame whoever is in my way. I'm here to take care of me. I'm here to just defend myself. And if that's where you and I are, I pray that God will free us from the influence of Satan in our lives. That we would say, no more. No more, and I need forgiveness, Lord. I don't want to be a thief. I don't want to be a robber. I don't want to be like that to people that are around me. The second person is this certain man. You know, it called him a certain man. Verse 30 in the beginning, when Jesus starts talking, he says, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. And the thing is, a lot of times we are just like this certain man. The path of this guy is going up or going down, we said. Down. And where was he? Where was he? Jerusalem. And where's he going? Jericho. Is Jericho a good place to be? No. Why not? Is there a history about Jericho? Any ideas? Joshua 6, 26. This is, they're going into Jericho. The first time they come into an interaction with Jericho, they're going to go and they're going to fight the war against Jericho and they're going to defeat Jericho. So here's what Joshua says about Jericho. Verse Joshua 6, 26. Then Joshua charged them at that time saying, "Cursed be the man before the Lord who rises up and builds the city Jericho." This is a cursed city. Anyone who builds it, here's what's going to happen to him. He shall lay its foundation with his firstborn. When he starts to build it, the foundation, right at the beginning, nothing has happened up yet. Firstborn is going to, something bad is going to happen to them. And with his youngest, he shall set up his gates. And then when he's coming to get the gates, his youngest child, something's going to happen to them. And that's exactly what happened. The first king to ever rebuild Jericho, his firstborn son died when they built the foundation. And when they're doing the gates, his youngest son died. It's a cursed city. Jericho is a symbol of the world. Jerusalem is a symbol of the place where God is, where the presence of God, where place of worship, the place of fellowship with people. And then this guy is not going up in his walk with God, but he's going down in his walk with God. He's going from Jerusalem to Jericho. He's going from a place of worship to a place where he goes and he wants to see what the world is like. Come on, man, don't be so uptight. You weird, uptight Christians, you guys are weird everywhere, man. You go to those weddings, y'all are weird. Loosen up, man. Dude, don't you know how to have fun? A certain man symbolizes a person who either has a relationship with God or thinks he has a superficial relationship with God, but is tired of it, wants to dabble a little, wants to see what it's like outside, wants to see what the world is like. There's a compromise in the heart, and they're going down, and they're going down, and it's a steep slope when we start going down that way. You know, I'm going to tell you about a great guy, a really great man of faith that we all look up to him, that had the same scenario happen to him. In Genesis chapter 12, Abraham, from verse 7. So here then the Lord appeared to Abraham, and said, "To your descendants I will give this land." So here he got to Canaan, the promised land, and that he told him, "Come out, leave your family." So he got there finally. And then something amazing happened. Who appeared to Abraham? The Lord himself. I mean, who would be excited? Who would want the Lord to appear to them? I think all of us will raise our hand. Yeah, me, man. I want the Lord to appear to me. So here, the Lord appeared to him, but it wasn't just an appearance, but appearance and also language. There was speaking that happened. And the language was a promise that God gave him. "To your descendants, I will give this land." And so then, you know, wow, you're going to give me this land and to my seed, my descendants, my children? That's amazing. And that's it. That's the vision. The vision, and so it's audio and visual that he saw. And so what does Abraham do, or Abraham at that time before his name was changed? And then, and there he built an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. He says, wow, I'm going to build an altar here. This is a place of worship. Wow, Lord, I got to see you. I got to see your presence. I got to hear your promise. I am going to worship you here, and I'm going to build an altar. I need to remember this place, and I need to remember what you've done. Because you had appeared to me and I'm so unworthy, giving me your promises. Look at the next verse. So Abraham, and he moved from there to the mountain east of Bethel. Now it doesn't make any sense. Where is Canaan? What is Canaan to Abraham? The promised land. So he got to the promised land. And then after he got to the promised land, what did he do? He moved from there. Why? Does it make any sense to you? Okay, let's say it this way. I want you to move. This is God saying to you. I want you to move to Long Beach. You got to Long Beach and then you move out of Long Beach. Does that make any sense? Hello? Earth to Abraham. Why would you move? He moved from there. But unfortunately, what did he do? And he moved from there to the mountain east of Bethel. East in the Word of God, many times when it's mentioned, there's equal evil, sin. And so he leaves, he goes to a mountain east of where? Bethel. What's Bethel? Does anyone know what Bethel means? The house of God. You just built an altar. You're in the promised land. You leave the house of God and you go towards sin. What is wrong with you? So here he goes over. He's like, no, I don't know. It's too overwhelming. Sometimes like, you just saw God. God just spoke to you. The Lord just spoke to you. What is wrong with you? And he moved from there to the mountain east of Bethel. And he pitched his tent with Bethel on the west. And Ai on the east. What's on the east side? Ai. What is Ai? Ruin. What's ruin? The world. He says, no, don't worry. I'm still living in a tent. Isn't that what the bride said in Songs of Solomon? In Songs of Songs, she said that I am asleep, but my heart is awake. Yeah. And we do that a lot, guys. No, I'm asleep. You're next to me. And she goes like that, and he's gone. He left her. We think we're right on spiritually, and we want to hold the stick from the middle. We move east. But I'm looking the same place. I'm still the same Abraham. I'm still in a tent. I'm still a stranger. I'm still a pilgrim. I didn't buy a house there. I can move any time. But I'm going closer to ruin and further from Bethel, from the house of God. His heart is compromised. That's why it doesn't shock us to see what's coming next in this chapter. So he goes over there, and then there he built an altar to the Lord. No, I'm the same Abraham. Look, I'm still worshiping God. Abraham, you're not in the same place. You left the place where God wanted you. You left it when he just appeared to you, and he says, right here, is going to give this land to your descendants, and then you move right after that. You can build all the altars you want. You can have a tent all you want. But now your heart moved more east. You moved closer to ruin. And that's going to ruin your relationship with God. And called on the name of the Lord. And he says, I call on your name. But look at verse 9. So Abraham journeyed, going on still toward the south. And I love that word in Arabic, going on still toward the south. It kind of comes as like a ball. You have a slope, and then you just start the inertia. You start it, and it starts to roll slowly, and then it starts to roll faster. It's like a continual, like it's picking up that. And where is he going? South. South is down. So he's going worldly, and he's going down in his relationship with God, but it started to pick up. His walk going more worldly. So look at what happens to him next. Now there was a famine in the land. So now there's hunger. Well, of course there's going to be famine. When my relationship with God turns from a sincere, true relationship into one of looks, I have an altar, I have a tent, but I'm more east and more south than I used to be with God. I'm more worldly, I'm more in the ruin, and I'm more going down. Of course I'm going to be hungry, and I'm not going to make good decisions. So there was famine in the land, and Abraham went down to Egypt. So here, do you see, guys, east, south, and then, but it's not just south. It's going on still toward the south. He kept going. He can't stop from south. And then he goes, what? Not up to Egypt, but down to Egypt, going down, down, down. And like the song, it says, it's a slow fade. It starts slow, and then they're like, where? Now I'm like completely in sin and comfortable with it. I don't even know how I got from here to there. It started in the heart. Yeah, I can still go to church. Yeah, I still worship. Yeah, I still... No. Down to Egypt to dwell there. Whoa. He's making wrong decisions. Because he has family, he says, I'm going down to Egypt. Egypt is a symbol of the world. And then what is he doing? Are you going to visit there? No, I'm going to dwell there. I'm going to live there. I'm going to go, and this is going to be my new home, my new address. My new address is going to be the world. For the famine was severe in the land. And he had severe famine. So he's already way down spiritually. But look what happens. And it came to pass when he was close to entering Egypt. Now he's getting close to enter the world, The world's a rough place to be. He said to Sarai, his wife, "Indeed, I know that you are a woman of beautiful countenance." He says, "You are beautiful." You guys know how old is Sarai at this time? Bare minimum, 65. She's probably a little older, but at least 65. "You are beautiful. Therefore, it will happen when the Egyptians see you that they will say, 'This is his wife,' and they will kill me, but they will let you live. You're beautiful, and I'm gonna die. Please say you are my sister, that it may be well with me for your sake, and that I may live because of you." So what did he tell her? Lie. Lie, Sarai, lie. Why? Because it's all about me. Look at this. So, please say you are my sister, that it may be well with me for your sake. But it's about you, you know, I don't want you to be husbandless. And that I may live because of you. He became selfish. Lying became easy. It's a downhill slope. Luke 10:30, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. I wonder, maybe we don't identify with the thieves. Maybe we're not really hurting others. Maybe we're not calling others names and things like that. But maybe we're going down in our relationship with God. Maybe I'm going from strong to weaker, to weaker, to weaker. I'm telling you, and I praise God for the Bible. And I praise God when it takes a man like Abraham, who's like, if you want to talk about faith, and you want to talk about the top in the faith, the father of faith, it's Abraham. I thank God that even he had issues. So I'm telling you, you and I are not better than Abraham when it comes to faith. So you and I could easily fall, and Abraham didn't know. He didn't know what he had done. It's so subtle, it's so sneaky, it's so strict, it's so tricky how Satan just kind of like slopes us away until we're like all the way in Egypt hanging out over there. I was just in Bethel right now. What just happened? He just says a little east. But no, you need your altar. You need your tent. Okay? Just a little south. You know what? Why don't you just go down to Egypt? You're hungry. I think the world can satisfy you. You're hungry. Why don't you try some of these things? Why don't you get a little bit of the world? Come on, don't be so uptight. And it's a slow fade when then we end up being drunk by the world and we don't even know what just happened. And I wonder, maybe we identify with this man where we're compromised in our walk with God and our desires and our passion is starting to become more worldly. We want to try the things of the world. And then we're like, I don't know how I just lied. Well, the answer is not that. The answer is we've already compromised our walk with God. And that's why it became a continual slope going downward in our walk. And if you or I identify with this man, you know, I'm telling you, there are thieves waiting. Satan just waits to see that rolling, and he's ready to jump us. He's ready to beat us up. He wants the end. He promises the world, but he doesn't want to give us the world. He wants to kill us. He wants to leave us dead if he can, but if he can't, because of God's grace, he wants to leave us half dead, if that's the max that God will allow him to do to us. And I really pray that we would go away. It doesn't feel good to be beat up. It doesn't feel good. When Abraham came out of Egypt, he came out, but not everyone recovered. He recovered. But Lot didn't recover. When Lot looked at the land of when they had to split up, and Lot's like, Abraham said, "You choose. You pick first. I'm going to be the adult here. I'm going to allow you to choose first." He says he looked at the land of Sodom and Gomorrah, that it was like the Garden of Eden. Wow, beautiful. Like the land of Egypt. Egypt never came out of Lot, even though Lot is what a believer. Read 2 Peter. Lot is a believer, but the world never, he went into the world because of Abraham. but the world never came out of him. Abraham went into the world, but when he came out, the world came out of him. But the thing is, he hurt others with him. And I really pray that we don't dabble. Don't get too curious with the things of the world. It's going to get us into trouble. Don't start saying, come on, man. When you get that thought, just say, Lord, I need your help. I need you, because I know Satan is not going to give me anything. He just wants to hurt me. He wants to do things to me. You know, one of the stories that talks about what Satan really likes to do, and I love it in the Gospel of Mark chapter 5, is that that demon-possessed man with legion, it says that he was naked. Wait a minute, this is what happened to this guy. They made him naked. And then he was out of his mind. They couldn't chain him. He would wound himself. This guy was wounded, wasn't he? They wounded him. And then who was hanging out with him, with the guy with the legion? It says he was alone, living in the tombs. And they departed, and they left him. That's the work of Satan. Only Satan does that. And I pray, if you or I are there, say, Lord, I don't want to go down anymore, but take me back. Take me to remember that better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Now, I want to go to the next guy, which is a priest. In verse 31, now, by chance, a certain priest came down that road. And I could tell you it was not by chance. This was God's will for that guy to be there. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So this guy is walking, 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 and then he sees a beat-up guy, half dead. What does he do? Huh? Walks on the other side. He's like, whoop, ooh. And then, did he pause? Did he stop? He just went, kept going, as if he never seen this guy. And a priest came down that road, and he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And this guy, to me, symbolizes those spiritual people, maybe even spiritual leaders. People who just, I always go to church. Listen, I was just in Jerusalem. And actually, right now, I'm on my way to Jerusalem. I'm going the other way from this guy. I'm going up to worship. I'm going up to serve God. I'm a priest. I'm going to do my priestly duties. I'm going to do all these things. And they're going on their path to do that. But when someone needs help, they don't help nobody. They don't do anything to help anyone who is in danger. Now, can you blame the priest? Okay. Now, let's just talk like real life, okay? We are not in the United States of America, well-lit roads, very populated areas. We're talking about, let's consider this a remote place in a country where there's no rules, no government, none of that stuff, and you see someone beat up. Would you stop? Okay, fine, let's do it this way, okay? Let's say you're driving on the freeway in California. You're the only car on the freeway at 3 a.m. First of all, you shouldn't be on the freeway at 3 a.m., okay? But just let's pretend. So at 3 a.m., and then you see a stopped car, someone wanting help. Are you going to stop? Come on. Why not? They need your help. What would make you not stop? Scared. What are you scared of? They're the one who need help. You're the one in the car. What if they need your cell phone? You don't know what? What don't you know? Well, you're so mean. What don't you know? You just what? You pray for them and you leave. So what are you, the priest? Why not? I'm trying to drive a point here that this guy, we can't really blame him. Why don't you stop? Because they could be faking it, right? It could be like you're going down, huh? What if it's a setup? Has that ever happened? No? It always happens. Wow, you guys are not. Huh? He's half dead, so he's not saying ow or anything. The guy's half dead, so he's just... So you don't know if he's really like, oh, and then does anyone say, oh, how about people with the sign, you know, they're like, oh, look, you know, It's not always true. Some are true, but you know what I mean? He has good excuses. He's not trying to be non-spiritual. He says, listen, this could be a setup. Or he could say, you know, actually, if that guy is not, if it's not a setup and it's a true thing, the guy got beat up here, what does that make this the spot of who did this to him? Thieves. And those are not weak thieves. They got some, they didn't beat up a lady or a kid. They beat up a grown man. Okay? So they're pretty strong. And priests are old people. So he's like, why would I stop there? Because I could get beat up too. While I'm looking, I can't see behind my shoulder. There's no one around. I don't want to. He's got good excuses. Right? But I'm saying a lot of us sometimes are just like the priest. We don't help nobody. And we've got so many logical excuses to help nobody. Listen, I'm neutral. Do you go to church? I never miss church. Do you do anything? I actually serve God at church. Do you do anything to help anybody? No. But I will never miss church. And I tell you, you know, if you ask in churches, hey, most churches, you know, say, hey, we need help with something, a project, they say 10% of the people in any given church do 90% of the work. Why? The rest are a bunch of priests. They go to church, they attend, they never do anything. And you know, I'd like to read you from the Gospel of Luke itself, the next chapter, in just one verse, verse 23. Jesus says, he who is not with me, if you're not with me, is against me. You're against me. And he who does not gather with me scatters. So what is he saying? He's saying, if you want to be neutral, listen, are you against me? No. Jesus asks. Well, are you with me? No. Then you actually are against me, he says. If you choose not to be with me, if you're not full on signed up with me, you're against me. And if you don't gather, you scatter. So meaning, if you, he's not saying if you are a harmful believer. No, he's saying if you're a believer who doesn't do any work, you don't gather, you don't try to help with the kingdom of God, you don't try to help with the field of the Lord, you're actually scattering. You're causing damage in the kingdom of God. And that's what that priest was. He thinks he's holier than thou. He thinks that he is such a man of God. He serves God. He praises God. He lives for God. He never misses church. He's always there. And he actually maybe signs up for stuff, but he never helps nobody. I really pray that if you and I are this person, we don't ever pause for anybody. He didn't pause. He just went, no, this is going to inconvenience me. Well, it's going to make me late for church. I'm going to across the other way. I'm going to go and pass. I pray if we're the type of people that never want to be inconvenienced, that we don't stop for anybody unless it fits with me, for me to help you, I'm not pausing. I pray that we come before God and say, Lord, I want to repent. I want to be one who helps. I want to be one who serves these people who are hurting, that have fallen on their path, that have, yes, it's frustrating. Yes, it's hard. Yes, it actually takes effort, as we're going to see. And it's costly to have mercy on someone. But I want to be like you, Jesus. And so some people are a priest. And I pray if you and I are, that we repent and we say, Lord, I don't want to be a priest anymore. The next one is a Levi, verse 32. Likewise, a Levite of Luke 10, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. So is he a little better or worse or same as the other guy? The priest. What do you think? Huh? So same end result. Did he slow down at least? Or no? Okay, so let's read again. Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked. The other guy was walking and he passed and he went to the other side and passed by on the other side. So if you read, the guy went. And so he came to the area. The other guy never even came to the area. So he came to the area. He looked And then he passed by on the other. So to me, I think he's a better guy. He's less holier than thou than the other guy. He paused, but in the end result, he didn't do anything. He still didn't help the guy. And this, to me, you know, symbolizes those who are always, you know, that come to church, never miss church, always there, and always love to give advice, but never help anybody. Just give advice. They remind me of James chapter 2. James chapter 2, verse 14. What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, so they have two problems, clothing problem and a hunger problem, and one of you says to them, I'm a Levite, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? So, yeah, good job. You recognize that they're naked. You recognize that they're hungry. And you said, I have some advice for you, brother. I have some advice for you, sister. Please go in peace. God is good. Be warmed, okay? You need some clothes. And be filled. Need some food. Goodbye. What does it profit them? Duh. Everyone knows that. Anyone can give that advice. Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. A Levite. Experts at advising people. Experts, hey, go in peace. The Lord says this, but we're never there for anybody. We're never there for the actual practical thing that they're there for and that they are in need of. And I pray if you and I are a Levite, say, Lord, I don't want to be one who just sits and watches, stands and watches, and then leaves. The other guy leaves right away. Fine, I'm better than them. I actually sit there, I evaluate, and then I give my advice, and then I leave. Wow, good for you. But a lot of us are just either we don't want to be involved, or our involvement is only to give you some words of advice and take off. Never helping both of them, and the end result did not help this poor guy who's half dead. The last one I want to talk about is the Samaritan. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. See, all three of them saw this guy. One just left, one stopped and left, and then this Samaritan. He came right where he was, and when he saw him, first thing he had is he had sincerity. He had compassion on this guy. Now, the man who is half dead is a Jew. This man is what a Samaritan. Is there an issue with the relationship here or no? Yes. What's the issue? Jews don't like Samaritans, okay? I agree. So do Samaritans like Jews? No. So I'll share with you a couple of verses from the Bible, and we can try to come with a conclusion. So two verses, John 4:9. Remember the Samaritan woman? Then the woman of Samaria, when Jesus started speaking to her, he said, give me a drink. Verse 9 says, then the woman of Samaria said to him, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? Well, what's the problem with that? She says, I'll tell you what the problem with that is. Well, she didn't quite say it like that, but you know what I mean. For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Y'all hate us. We don't have a problem with you, but you hate us. Now, flip a few more chapters. John 8, verse 48. So, Jesus was speaking, and then they're really upset with him. Then the Jews answered and said to him, do we not say rightly that you are a Samaritan? Oh, they didn't stop there. And have a demon? They hate Samaritans. To them, a Samaritan is equal to a demon-possessed person. You got a demon inside, you're a Samaritan, you're a demon. You have a demon. They hate them. Now, the Samaritans, we don't know. They could possibly, I mean, if someone hates you, after a while, what normal people, what do? I mean, the bare minimum, you don't associate with them, but usually you're like, I hate that guy. Why? Because they hate me.
you know, but fine, you could be neutral. So we could say they're either neutral or they maybe hate them. So this Samaritan guy comes to someone who he knows hates him, right? Are the Jews neutral when it comes to Samaritans? I think the Bible is quite clear. No, they're not. Samaritans, you could say the least, they're at least offended by it, or at least they're shocked if a Jew comes their way. We saw that in the Samaritan woman. How could you talk to me? You know, I'm a Samaritan woman, Jewish man. You know, Jews don't deal with Samaritans. Have you not heard that thing that you guys wrote? Samaritan goes to someone who hates him. And his first reaction to the person who hates them is, "You're hurting. I have compassion on you." I'm telling you, this is really hard. For the priest to have compassion on this Jewish man would make a lot of sense. For the Levite to have compassion on this man would be logical. Unfortunately, neither did. But for the Samaritan to have compassion on the Jewish man who's half dead, that does not make any sense. And this is what Christ is saying. He did not answer the guy's question. He answered a deeper question. Or he said, "I have a deeper expectation of you believers." And that is, I want you, as he said it in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, in the Sermon on the Mount, I want you to love your enemy. I'm not talking about your relationship with believers. I'm talking about your relationship with enemies. I want you to love your enemy. I want you, when you see your enemy hurting, I don't want you to say, "Good, you deserve it." Or that's less than what you deserve, like Job's friend said to him. But I want you to have compassion. Go there. Be right there for them. And have compassion on them. He had compassion. That's the first thing. He's just full of action. And then he went to him. Second thing is he got even closer. I mean, aren't you scared? This is a place where there's a bunch of thieves. No, I'm not. I care about this guy. I have compassion on him. And bandaged his wounds. He's here. He says, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to deal with what exactly it is that he is in need of right now. It's not time to talk to the guy. It's not time to have a conversation. It's time. There's some open, fresh wounds here that I need to deal with, that I need to bandage up, that I need to try to treat and to do that. Now, did he risk himself? Yes, he risked his life because the thieves could have been right there watching and went to attack him. I mean, if the guy had bandages, he must have had a lot more than the other guy. But he didn't just have bandages, and then he poured oil, and oil is costly, you know? And so he poured oil and wine. He had lots of money on him. He was traveling, not light. And he came and he said, "I am going to give you help." And I'm now applying this not to Jesus, but to us. We need to look at our enemy with love now. And we need to, when they're hurting, not go and add to their hurt or even leave them alone. We need to go out of our way to have compassion, but not just have compassion, deal with the wound. And the only way you or I could ever be of any help to anyone who's hurting is if we go with the Holy Spirit. You who are spiritual, go and correct such a one with a spirit of gentleness, knowing that you're not any better than them. You could fall in the same old thing. You could be very easily tomorrow on your way from Jerusalem to Jericho. It happened to Abraham. You could be on the mountaintop spiritually and tomorrow your way down there. Be humble. You're not above it. And so you need the Holy Spirit. You need the gentleness of God, and you need to pour it. You need to pour just generously the Holy Spirit, oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal. Just use your resources and bring them on and just shower them with the love of God and as the love of God is revealed to us through the Holy Spirit. That's what Romans 5 says, right? And own animal brought him to an inn. And, you know, if you see a sinner and let's say you're able to bring the sinner to Christ, you don't have to bring him to your church, just an inn, just somewhere where, you know, it's solid that people can go and grow. Just take them there to a place where they will be safe, to an inn, and took care of him. Take care of this person. Take care of them. Water them.
shower them with the love of God. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii. True mercy is costly. True mercy, true compassion is going to cost us. And so whether that's time, whether that's resources, whether that's money, it costs. But for the Samaritan, it cost him everything, time, resources, and money. And gave them to the innkeeper and said to him, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you. These are the 5. If you want to add the innkeeper, you can say people that are in your church, within your local circle of spiritual friends. Are you taking care of them? That's the 6th one. Where are you and where am I? Maybe you and I identify ourselves with more than one of these people. But the question is, what are we going to do about it? If we identify ourselves as the thieves, we need to repent and stop hurting people. If we identify ourselves as priests, spiritual people who are very involved, yet never involved, very involved, yet never help anybody, never affect anyone's life. God wants us to be effective. Maybe I'm a Levite. Maybe I just pause and I look and evaluate and I talk a lot. But I still end up helping nobody. God wants me to be effective with people around me. But maybe you're a Samaritan. Tell him, Lord, increase the compassion that I have. Let me not look for who is my neighbor, what's the bare minimum I can do toward people around me, but let me be a neighbor, even to my enemy, to those who hate me, to those, I did not make them my enemy, they made themselves my enemy, they actually hate my guts, but I'm going to have compassion on them. I'm going to love my enemy like you've taught me, and I'm going to pay for it. I'm going to pay for it with my stuff, with my resources. I'm going to pay for it with my money. I'm going to do whatever I want. My reading today in the Gospel of Luke talked about the steward, the bad steward, and then how he was caught, that he was ripping the guy off, and then he went at the end, and then he's like, oh, how much do you owe? Give me this much. Give me this much. And then he says, the sinners use their money much more wisely. This is the Lord's commentary on it. Sinners use their money much more wisely than we believers. So he says it's called the money of darkness. Don't hold on to it. Just be a Samaritan to people, or be an innkeeper. Be someone who's there to take care of those who have brought you wounded and help in the healing process. And just want us to spend a few minutes in prayer, and just maybe to reflect a little bit to see where are we? Where are we and who am I tonight? And if the Lord spoke to you about something specific, maybe just put it before him. And to see how we can turn from thieves, priests, Levites into Samaritans and innkeepers. If anyone wants to pray out loud. Thank you.